every time we would have this homecoming. I can remember standing here and reading this, the history of the church. You know, this church has a wonderful history of people coming, serving God, working for God. So I'm going to try to read this morning. Hallelujah, Jesus. It says, I would like to say welcome to all of you that are a witness today. And to all of you that have been pastors, I hope this will bless you and bring back pleasant memories to you. I was thinking about our pastors here at Strawberry 2, and you know, there's some of them that are still here. I've talked to some of them this week. They had other obligations and stuff. But you know, we've got a lot of pastors that's already gone home to glory. They're probably up there waiting for us to come and join them for us. Hallelujah. And since we have come a long way in the past 128 years, I'm sure it's been more than that now, but Denise did an update for me here at Strawberry. When I came to live in the Strawberry area, there was a little one-room building with a wood stove and oil lamps and three or four windows on each side for light. And when I talked to Angie, she said that Lucille didn't say window, she said winders. She said there was winders on there, and that's just our heritage, right? Our bathrooms were little outhouses, and you waited your turn in line. There was a well out front and a spring in the back where we got our water to drink. We had school and church there. It was told to me this ground was deeded to the Strawberry School District number 55 on May 7, 1886. It was also told to me back in July of 1907 that community revivals were held in Happy Holler. The altar was a rock. Preachers from different places came to preach and enjoy the blessings of the Lord. I am proud to live in a community that has a long history of people preaching God's word and shouting his blessings before I came to live here. It says two schoolhouses have burnt down. In 1949, this ground, a little one-room school, was purchased by the Assemblies of God. Reverend W.R. Kelton was the pastor at that time. Ezra Pitts, Lindley Tumbleson, and Dee Galantine were the trustees. So this little one-room schoolhouse has enlarged to this size, which we are so proud of today, but not without a lot of hard work. From 1965 to 1973, Brother R.L. Norton was our pastor. He was a carpenter, and he drew up the blueprints for a new church. He and his helpers almost had the church finished when he was killed in an automobile accident. The church was without a pastor and in debt, heartbroken and sad. We prayed for the Lord's help. The Ada Mills family paid off this debt so the church could survive. The Mills family had attended services on special occasions. Several pastors have helped in finishing the church. On October 5th, 1985, Strawberry celebrated the 100th year and first homecoming. Leon and Leslie Ketcherside were our pastors. They were our pastors for 6 years. They were here longer than any other pastor. In 1990, the Fellowship Hall was built in memory of Janice Graves Holman. On October 14, 1994, around 2:30 a.m., tragedy struck our church again. The church was burned down to the ground, and the Fellowship Hall was gutted by the fire. But this did not destroy us. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
The Hagerville Community Building allowed us to have services there. Section 5 North Home Missions Team came down from Fort Smith to help build back our church and fellowship hall. Brother Darrell Selby was our pastor at this time. January 29, 1995 was the first service in our new church with 54 in attendance. April 16, 1995, the new church and fellowship hall was dedicated. Brother E. Joe Wilmoth, our district superintendent, preached the service. Brother Selby resigned the church in May of 1996 due to his health. He passed away only a week later. After appointing a new pastor, the church decided to provide a better parsonage. In July of 1996, we purchased a new double-wide trailer for our pastor's family to live in. In August of 1996, Brother Eddie Birdsong became our pastor. The men of the church built on a front porch. Brother Birdsong and his family were with us from 1996 until 1997. In January 1998, Reverend and Mrs. Dunn became our pastor. Brother Dunn and the men of the church put a new porch on the front of the parsonage, and this time they put a roof on it as well. I think they did a real good job. And they kept it up. Brother Dunn left us and went to another church, and not long after, the Lord called him home. Brother and Sister Willis became our pastors. We enjoyed some good services and bought a new riding lawnmower and painted the church. We also purchased new songbooks. These right here we're still using today. We voted the Willises in for 3 more years. I said, if they can stand us, we can stand them. They made it in 1 year. After the Willises left, various preachers helped us out. Then, 2003, Brother and Sister Caldwell were elected pastor. However, due to bad health, they only stayed a few months. Again, various preachers filled in. In August of 2004, we elected Brother Larry and Sister Ruby Skinner. In September of 2005, the church parking lot was paved. After that, we kind of just have a little rough sketch of some things. Dates, we'll try to get this updated. But when Brother Terry Savalas was here, that's when the church got a van and put metal roofs on the church and the fellowship hall, and they added to the fellowship hall. When Brother McGuire was here, the church got painted again, the cross was put at the front, the sound booth was added, and this beautiful piano came to the church. Hallelujah. When the prices were here, not that way I've been was that van was stolen. But was it 2020 when we got this one?
Yeah.
Last year? We were blessed with another van, which we're working to get together, and we took it on a few outings, and we want to use that van for the glory of God.
Yes,
and in 2019 is when Brother and Sister Petty came to be our pastors. In 2020.
That's a good year.
This is 21, so we're going to
have
to
okay,
good
night.
I'm going to have to take you. Come on, give me a break. And today is not only our homecoming, but Pastor Bruce gets today. But Brother and Sister Penny will come up. We have, I'm going to tell you guys. And I'm shopping. And I found these plaques. And I said, you know, those would be wonderful plaques for our pastor and his wife. I think I'll go ahead and get them and maybe we can put them in with their Christmas gift or something like that. I had no idea that Pastor Appreciation Month was coming up or exactly when it was. But this plaque says, to our pastor, a pastor is a shepherd called of God to lead the flock. A man of courage, love, and faith, trusting Christ, the solid rock. A teacher and a confidant, a helper and a friend, a guide to lead the lost to Christ in a darkened land. You are this special man of God, and we want you to know we are thankful for you, Pastor, and we appreciate you so. For our pastor's wife, it takes a special person to be a pastor's wife. And I know this for a fact because my mom was one. And I know what it does to a family, to the pastor's wife. Hallelujah. It takes a special person to be a pastor's wife, for it is not a simple job or an easy way of life. The phone rings at dinner time, in the middle of the night, and then counting everything else. The patients, they are few. With so many needs in the church, there is always lots to do. So keep this in a special place so you will always know you are a special gift from God, and we appreciate you so. And we also have a card, which I think just about, I got around there for almost as many as I could this morning to get everybody to sign the card, just tell them how much we appreciate them and love them. We have a card. And if you remember, in June for their anniversary, 50th anniversary, we told them they could go to Branson for a couple of nights, and they're going this week. Bye.